Hi friends, this is Dr. Karthik. I am an endodontist, master teacher in RDET MBS. So this is the best platform for NEET MBS preparation and INICET preparation, which gives you complete package of all the videos, question bank and test series and motivational series, so which you can able to come the top position in any exam related to the MBS. So this is the proverb which I like very much. Our power is within you. You can do anything and everything, which is given by Vivekananda. And always, always dream. Dream big. Okay, allow yourself to imagine that you are going to reach your destination, what you dream about. So all the toppers, all the millionaires, today they came to top position because it started with a small dream. The dreams became thoughts. The thoughts became practice. Repeated practice which leads to the success. If your dreams does not scare you, that means you are not big enough. Right. So in this particular session, we are going to discuss three different type of parts. Number one, image based question, and number two, concept based question or clinical based question. Number three, fact based question. So stay with us for the particular sessions for the concept based and your fact based questions. Right, so this is one of the questions which was asked in the exam. Identify the following board. So this is polymer board. By eliminating all the other options, you can go for this particular option, polymer board. So what is this polymer board? What is the very special about this polymer board when compared to the diamond and carbide boards? So the polymer boards which will fall under minimal invasive dentistry. So this polymer board, otherwise called as SMART board. Right. So there are some materials which are called SMART materials in dentistry. So one of the SMART material is your polymer boards. Why it is called a SMART material? The reason is, so when you remove the diamond board or carbide board, it removes the normal healthy structure along with the decayed tooth. But today's concept is minimal invasive dentistry, which was evolving the old concept which was given by J.V. Black. So the concept of J.V. Black is extension for prevention, right? So, but now many people's or patients doesn't like this amalgam restoration, extension for prevention. Even if you remove the caries in 1 millimeter, you have to give depth of 1.5 millimeter for an amalgam restoration. You have to remove the normal healthy tooth structure also for the amalgam to stay there. But today's concept is go for like a material GEC or composite, which just ulta, that is prevention for extension. So this concept which was given by and classification was given by a person called as Mountain Hugh. And you know very well about this classification given by J.V. Black, right? That is class 1 to class 6. But the Mountain Hugh classification for the minimal invasive dentistry is based on the site where it located, whether it is a pit and fissure, cervical area, contact area, and what is the size. So the classification for minimal invasive dentistry is based on site and size. Right, next. What are the other things will come under minimal invasive dentistry? So the concept of minimal invasive dentistry is preserving the normal tooth structure. So here, ART, chemomechanical caries removal, all this will come under minimal invasive dentistry. So what is this chemomechanical caries removal? Chemomechanical caries removal is you have to apply the chemical, that is chemo, over the decayed tooth. This chemical softens only the decayed part of the tooth. So once it softens, take your hand instrument, remove the softened part. It is the mechanical part. So here also you are preserving the normal tooth structure. So it is also one of the minimal invasive dentistry part. Example for chemomechanical caries removal is Carisol, Caridex, and Papaid. So these are the different chemomechanical cage is removed part. Right. Coming to the next question. Identify the name of the rubber dam frame. So this is the question which was asked. So answer for this is star VC frame. So many of the students will confuse whether it is an I-cord or spray frame. Yes, for this I just put all the frames together. So these are the different types of frames. So first of all, we have to know the use of the frame. So the frame which is used to hold the rubber dam sheet. So we have a U-type frame like this. So this U-type frame, either it is made up of a metal or plastic. So if it is a metal, it is Young's frame. And if it is a plastic, it is Nygaard aspect. Where you heard about Nygaard aspect? In Indo, yes, EDTA, which is given by Nygaard aspect. And this is what the question asked. It is called as starlight visi frame or star visi frame. And this is a flexible bending type of rubber dam frame. This is called leak adder article rubber dam frame. And this is what called as handy dam, octro dam, insti dam, dry dam. So these are the different types of rubber dam frames. In next exams, they may ask you, apart from this, either leak adder article rubber dam or octro dam, they may ask you in question. So all these are octro dam, insti dam, dry dam, and all this are which is a foldable or so does not have this rubber dam sheet is attached with this, so does not need any frame. So this is called frameless rubber dam, right? So the next question. So one important thing which you have to notice in NEET exam is, so there are few topics they just concentrated. So in a particular topic they just asked two or three questions. So in a rubber dam, apart from this frame, they asked one more question. So what is this forceps? So the forceps, which is called as retainer forceps, which is used for to remove and apply the rubber dam clamp. So you know what is forceps and you know what is called frame. And apart from this, what are the other things which present in your rubber dam kit? So these are the different types of retainer forceps. Number one, Stokes, Brewer, and Ash type. So these are the, just keep in mind, these are the types of rubber dam forceps. So they may ask you a question like, all these are type of rubber dam forceps except. Right. And apart from this, in a kit, rubber dam kit, you have a rubber dam sheet and rubber dam template. So rubber dam sheet, which has a, available in two sizes. One is 5 into 5 inches. And 6 into 6 inches. So 5 inch of the width and length. So 5 into 5 inch, which is used for children's, and the 6 into 6, which is used for adults. Right, and it has various thickness. Like it starts from thin, medium, heavy, extra heavy, special heavy. So the thin, which is having a thickness of 0.006 inch, medium 008, heavy 10, extra heavy 12, and special heavy 14. Right? So these are the things which you have to know for the rubber dam sheet. And this is called rubber dam template. So rubber dam template is just to use, you have to place the particular area where you have to place the rubber dam sheet. Just place the rubber dam sheet over the template and mark the area particular where you have to go to treat the patient. Right. And apart from this, you have a rubber dam punch and rubber dam clamp. So rubber dam punch, if you see, you have a various size of holes. So based on the mesiodistal dimension of the teeth, you can able to select the particular hole. So if the mesiodistal dimension is smaller, you can go for a smaller size hole. And if the mesiodistal dimension is larger, like mandibular for smaller, you can go for a large size. And a rubber dam clamp, which has a two types, number one winged clamp and number two wingless clamp. So this is what called as wing. So the use of the wing is, extra retraction of the rubber dam is achieved with the winged rubber dam, which provides more accessibility, visibility to the area where you are walking. But there are disadvantages associated with the winged rubber dam, like placing the wedges and mattress band is very difficult in case of winged rubber dam. And what are the parts of rubber dam clamp? So this sharp projection, which is called as prongs. So there are four prongs, and the extension from the prongs, this area, is called as jaws, and the area which connecting the two jaws is called as bow. So if they ask you what are the parts of rubber dam clamp, you have a four prongs, two jaws and one bow. Clear? So these are the things which you have to know for the rubber dam kit. Next question, which is very easy question, this is given a diagram like this and asked about what is this particular form, convergence of the cavity preparation which provides what. So many of the students which eliminate the third option and fourth option, right, they think that they either go for a resistance form or retention form. Many students have confusion like this. So it is very easy. Throw out all the things what you learned in your BDS time. So all the definitions related to the resistance form, retention form for your Viva. So in case if you have confusion, right? I just teach you how to remember without any confusion for the resistance and retention form. So resistance form is something like resistance to fracture. Just imagine or just keep in mind this one word for the resistance form. Resistance form is resist to fracture. Resist to fracture. And retention form, which prevents the dislodgement of the restoration. That's it. And what are the features will come under retention form? Number one, convergence. And number two, douting. So these are the two things only will come for retention form. For a resistance form, number one, box shaped cavity, and number two, flat pulpal floor, and number three, adequate depth of the cavity, number four, roundening of the line angle, cusp capping. All this will come under resistance form. So next exam they may give you, right, all these are features of resistance form, or which is resistance form, which is retention form. You may get it a question like this. So just go through this and keep in mind what is called resistance and what is called retention. Right, this is one more image based question which was asked. So what is the groove which present here? So this groove is called as palatoradicular groove, otherwise called as cingulo-radicular groove, means which starts from the cingulum and it goes to the root surface, otherwise called as distolingual groove, mean it is more common on the distal surface, right? And which teeth is most commonly affected? Maxillary lateral incisor is the most commonly affected teeth by the palatoradicular groove. Many of the enamels which occur maxillary lateral incisor, so even palatoradicular groove which is more common on maxillary lateral incisor, right? So what are the other things which we have to know for palatoradicular groove? So number one, so this is a lesion called endoperio lesion. So both the department of endo and perio, so they have to be treat this palatoradicular groove. Number one, in endo, they have to take in periapical radiograph. So in a periapical radiograph, number one, they can see the periapical abscess related to the particular tooth. Number two, they can able to see two vertical line extending on the root surface. So these are the diagnostic part of endo. So the treatment part of endo is root canal treatment. They have to go for an abscess opening, clipping and shaping, followed by obturation, and send it to the perio department. Okay, so why they are sending for perio department? So the infection is present inside the root canal, which comes out through the groove to the periodontal ligament area, and it degenerates those periodontal ligament tissues, which leads to the parquet. So a specific parquet which present along the groove present in the particular tooth. So in periodic department, they have to check for the packet and they have to go for what type of lesioning, either it is a type 1, type 2 or type 3. So what is the type 1? Type 1 is the groove which extended not more than coronal 1/3 of the root. This is called type 1. Type 2 and type 3 is the groove which extended more than coronal 1/3 of the root. And what is the difference between type 2 and type 3? Type 2 which is a shallow groove and type 3 which is a deep groove. So which is a preferable material to close the particular parietal radicular groove? Bio-dentin or MTA? Bio-dentin is preferable than MTA. The reason for this is MTA takes time to set. And in the particular time there may be some disintegration occur. Also manipulation of bio-dentin is comparatively easier than MTA. So bio-dentin is a preferable material than MTA. Right. So coming to the next question. Which irrigating solution which gives the bubbling action when irrigate? So the answer for this is sodium hypochlorite. So the particular test which is called Champfain test. So when you irrigate the sodium hypochlorite, especially in the undetected canal, the sodium hypochlorite goes and react with the organic debris and produces bubbling action. So you can be able to identify the undetected canals. Right, what are the unique property of the other irrigating solutions? Sodium hypochlorite is the best organic solvent. So when you irrigate the canal with sodium hypochlorite, so it removes the organic debris completely. So this is the best irrigating solution. EDTA, which is otherwise a chelating agent, so it reacts with the inorganic part. Right, and next is chlorhexidine. Chlorhexidine, which has a property called as substandivity. And what is the meaning of substandivity? Even after you complete the irrigation process, the action of chlorhexidine remains stay for up to 72 hours. So this is what called as substandivity property of the chlorhexidine. Hydrogen peroxide. Hydrogen peroxide which produces nascent oxygen, which kills most of the microorganisms. Right, so these are the things which you have to know for the unique property of the other irrigating solutions. And what is this particular tooth? So this is having a 5 cusp, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So which teeth has 5 cusp? Yes, obviously mandibular first molar. Then it is a right side or left side? Now we have to go for which cusp is the largest in the mandibular first molar. Mesiobuccal is the largest cusp. So just imagine that you just take this particular tooth out and keep it on the right side. So when you just keep it on the right side, just imagine mesiobuccal cusp will present here. So but in the left side, if you place, it does not match, right? So just by imagining the particular tooth and keep it in the oral cavity, you can be able to tell whether it is a right side or left side. So this belongs to the occlusal surface of right mandibular first molar. And this is one more question which was asked from tooth morphology, right? So what teeth it is, especially premolar? So which teeth has two roots? Maxillary first premolar alone has two roots, so it is a maxillary first premolar. Now you have to tell whether it is a mesial side or a distal side. So mesial side, it has a very special feature called as mesial marginal developmental groove, right? This is the groove, so where it is present on the mesial side. So now we are able to tell you it is a mesial side, right? So two is the mesial side, right? So now you can go for this three option, you can eliminate this. And one is the buccal cusp and three is the lingual. So you can go for the third option. So by identifying the special feature of the particular tooth, you can be able to tell which tooth it belongs to. Right. This is one more question which was asked, very easy question. So especially they asked about this plane. Sorry, this plane. Okay, this is the plane they asked in the exam. So this is what called sagittal plane, right? So many students have again confused which is sagittal, which is transverse, which is coronal, or this. So I just give you a small idea how to remember this. So you know all the skull, right? Outline of the skull, and you have a various sutures. So what is this suture called as? Yes, this is sagittal suture, right? And this suture is coronal suture. Just If you know this, you can be able to answer for that question. So sagittal, which is like this, right? The sagittal, which divides the particular part into right side and left side. Coronal, which divides into front and back. Clear? Now come here. So this is what called as sagittal, which divides the person into right and left. So answer for this is sagittal. And coming to the coronal, this is called coronal plane. So coronal plane, which divides front and back, and this is what called as transverse plane, which divides the body into upper and lower. Right? So if some question comes hereafter from this particular part, you can able to answer easily. This is one more question which was asked from oral histology. So especially what is this part called as? So this is called as gubernacular canal. Right. So what is gubernacular canal? So in the distal teeth is there, the tooth germ of the permanent tooth present in the apical part of the distal teeth, which is completely covered by the bone. Okay. But a small area that's not covered by the bone, which is called as gubernacular canal, and which is filled with the loose connective tissue, which is called as gubernacular cord. Right? So this is the area. And this is not enough. You have to know what are the other options given in the exam, and you have to know what is the meaning of this. Right? So this is what called Hopman canals and Haversian canals, which is present in the bone. This Haversian canals, which is present along the or parallel to the bony surface, which provides nutrition to the bone. And the canal which connecting these two Haversian canal is called as Hopman canal. Right? And what is called canals of Hirschfeld and Joker handle, which is present there in between the root. You can able to see this in a radiograph. So this is called nutrient canals, which provides nutrition to the tooth. And so especially this area. So this is called canals of Hirschfeld and Joker handle. Alright. So this is a question, a clinical based or case based question, which was asked. The patient have a severe headache, neck stiffness, fever, and associated symptoms are present. So this particular syringe is used for the patient. So probably the patient have what pathology? Right. So the answer for this is meningitis. The reason now why I go for meningitis is the patient have neck stiffness. So neck stiffness is more preferable answer. I can go for meningitis, and other associated symptoms of meningitis are severe headache, fever, nausea, vomiting. Okay, and so all because all these are given, I can go for meningitis. Even I don't know what syringe it is. Okay, this is the syringe which is used for a lumbar puncture to identify what pathology the patient have. Whether the patient is having a bacterial meningitis, viral meningitis, or fungal meningitis. Microbiological examination. I can go for a lumbar puncture. So what is the site of lumbar puncture, which was asked in several exams? Between L3 and L4. Why specifically I can go for between L3 and L4? Is there any reason? Yes. So the solid structure of spinal cord, which ends at L2. So after L2, if I go, it is easy for me to collect the fluid, cerebrospinal fluid. So only I am going between L3 and L4. And what are the syringe size I can go for? For adults, I can go for a 22 gauge with 89 millimeter higher length. Children, I can go for a 23 gauge with 64 millimeter. And what is the position I can go with? So ask the patient to stay lying and bend it. So that I can able to go up to the depth of the lumbar area, I can able to collect the cerebrospinal fluid. Or I can go for the sitting position, ask the patient to bend it, and I can able to collect the cerebrospinal fluid. And it is a very skillful procedure. Okay, there are some, if the errors occur, it may cause even death of the patient. So you have to be very careful when collecting the cerebrospinal fluid. And what are the indications? Right, number one, in case of infection like meningitis, to identify what pathology it is. And number two, in case of subarachnoid hemorrhage, I can go for the lumbar puncture. What are the contraindications? In case of increased intracranial pressure, like brain abscess, and if there is any infection present on the puncture site. So again, it may be very dangerous for the patient. So a very particular sterile process is needed before collecting the cerebrospinal fluid from the patient. And this is one of the images which was given for the thyroid scan. They asked about what is the diagnosis. So patient is having intolerable to heat, weight loss. So all these are features of Graves' disease. So without seeing the image, you can go for the Graves' disease. But still, we have to know that what is the importance of the image. And so if some other picture is given to you, we have to be identified, right? So this is in a thyroid scan, injection of radionucleotide, and you have to take the scan. A normal thyroid which look like this. Graves' disease, a diffuse bilateral uptake of the radionucleotide scan will be taken, and this is a toxic multinodular goiter, which is a something haphazard pattern of the radionucleotide, and in a toxic adenoma, a particular nodule which takes the radionucleotide, which look like this. So this is the way to identify what is the patient having particular problem, right? So coming to this investigation step, so in case the patient is having elevated T3 and T4 and low TSH, mean thyroid stimulatory hormone is low, that means you can suspect the patient is having hyperthyroidism. So go for a thyroid scan. You can, in a thyroid scan, you may get it here four images like this. A diffuse bilateral uptake, so it just look like this. It is a Graves' disease. An irregular uptake, which is a toxic multinodular goiter. And a diminished uptake, so where you cannot see the back black color image. So more of white color area present, that is called thyroiditis. Solitary focal uptake, so which is present in a adenoma. A particular nodule alone takes the radionucleotide, which is seen in adenoma. So these are the four different type of images. In case if the patient is having a nodule, thyroid nodule, we can able to divide the patient into less than 1 millimeter and more than 1 millimeter. The chances of particular nodule which convert the cancer is very less when it is less than 1 millimeter. So if it is more than 1 millimeter, again you have to go for biochemical test. So in case the patient is having a low TSH, again the patient you can suspect hyperthyroidism, go for thyroid scan. And in a thyroid scan you may get it either a hot nodule or cold nodule. And heart nodule is, the chances of it converts into cancer is nil, almost nil. But in a cold nodule, the chances of it converting to cancer is 5%. So in case it is a cold nodule, again you have to go for FNAC. In case of normal thyroid stimulating hormone, okay, if the TSH is normal, you can go for a FNAC. In FNAC, you may get it at two results. Either it is a benign or malignant. Sometimes, you may get it a non-confirmatory. So, in case of non-confirmatory, you have to repeat the test of FNAC. So, these are the things which you have to know related to the thyroid scan. So, hope this particular session, which may be very useful for you, in case if you are preparing for your next NEET exam. And always, be happy when you're learning. So thank you so much. For other images and the concept based question, so stay with us. So this is the app, so kindly download this and you can able to get all access for related to the NEET MTS preparation. Thank you so much.